Welcome you to this afternoon's lecture. We are looking at accounting soft skills. That's accounting 201. And let's look at what is the definition. Accounting soft is defined as personal qualities, attributes, or level of commitment of a person that set him or her apart from other individuals who may have similar skill or experience. May I come again? Accounting soft skill is defined as personal qualities, attributes, or level of commitment of a person that sets him or her apart from other individuals who may have similar skill or experience. Oxford Dictionary 2012 defined soft skill as personal attribute that enables someone to interact effectively and harmoniously with other people. For example, communication skills, analytical skills, creative skills, teamwork, public speaking, interpersonal and decision making, and time management. Soft skill in accounting is beyond just counting numbers to management and other departments. It is important for accounting to be able to identify trends and improve solutions to problems. When looking for staff accounting and finance jobs, your search for candidates with necessary education and certification must be beyond diploma, degree, and designation. Let's look at making your decision looking for accounting and finance professional who possess these six skills. Number one is business skill. If you're employing anybody in finance or accounting, must possess the business skill. That means ability to do one business or the other, or to aid the business of the organization. Two, leadership capability skill. Now, you don't employ people just because they want to be moving numbers or writing numbers. You employ people so that at least as they grow in the ladder of success, they can also be leaders in different departments, if not possible, the organization. We also look at the technical prowess. There's power in techniques. If you have somebody who is not technically moving, or doesn't have senses, or doesn't belong to those class of technicians, then something must be wrong. You need to change that person. Three, communication skill. This is very, very important. It's one of the most powerful skill things needed. As you employ somebody, you must be able to communicate skill. You know, you don't employ people when you ask them to explain. Instead of explaining, they are crying. They say that's the way they communicate. That's not. You must be able to communicate good skill. Then four, customer service orientation. You know, I love, you know, sometimes moving people from area of specialty, they're moving them to other areas to test them to see if they are also very good. Then we also look at the sixth one, the best of the rest, that is ability to work well in teams and interdependently. That means you can work in a team, can support team. There are people who cannot work in a team. All they do is just work alone. And if anything is going to be added to them, they are going to fight it out. Then let's look at purpose of accounting education skill. Number one, beyond competence. Like I said to you, beyond your degree, beyond your diploma, beyond your designation. Yeah, those six things we talked about, you must add them to make you competent in your areas of accounting. Two, relationship between formal education and professional induction. Now, people believe that if you are not educated, formally, you cannot operate in other things. Well, I've seen people who are not really educated in other things, but are professionals. And like I met a bricklayer some times ago, whom I was talking about, I want to have something like a 3-bedroom flat. And he was able to tell me the amount of blocks I would use, amount of things. In fact, he told me how much would complete the 3-bedroom flat. So that's beyond formal education. Three, relationship between generic skill and specialization of accounting. generic skill. Those are the inbuilt skill and the specialization of accounting. Now let's look at the importance of soft skills. Soft skills are so much more important because they help to create better work environment, a better work environment. Also, it helps to understand the work that they do, which increase trust and facilitate problem solving. Now, don't forget, I've mentioned two things there. I said that it helps to create better work environment. Now, if you lack communication skill, you cannot create a very good work environment. And also, I told you, it helps to understand the work that they do, which increase trust and facilitate problem solving. Now, every organization goes through problems, but the way they solve the problem matters. But if you have people who are very creative, the technical how people, they help you to solve some problems. They remove headache from you. There are people, like take for example, somebody employed a driver and he said for the first time in 10 years, he could sleep, you know, while the guy was driving. Because seeing that the guy is competent enough and the man could rest. So let's look at the seven soft skills accountant must possess. The accountant must possess these seven skills if he's going to progress, if he's going to have effect in his area of business. Number one, leadership skill. Like I told you that every person you employ, don't employ for the sake of now, employ for the sake of future. You know, you've seen some leadership skills, leadership ability in them. And when those abilities comes up, you see that you'll be so happy because you'll be able to delegate authorities, you'll be able to delegate jobs, knowing very well that because he has a leadership skill, he could always, you know, maneuver things in the organization, or you could help the organization to climb to the next phase. Now, like the leadership skill, I do tell my students that there are a lot of people that they are not fit for jobs because they don't have the skill for the job. Why they are sacking some people, they are promoting some people, that means those people have something in them that others don't have. Then number two, teamwork. I have said it before, people cannot work in the team. A lot of people, once it comes to teamwork, they fail. They can't cope. You know, they believe that, you know, in fact, they are allergic to teams. They are very allergic to teams and they don't work with team. Then number three, communication skill. I told you, very important, very, very important communication skills, not only in figures, also in your prowess, in your thinking, in everything. You should be able to communicate things out, you know. Then number four, work ethic skill. Work ethic. There are people who don't have work ethic. They're always late for jobs, late for everything. They don't obey orders. They don't obey. No, you don't employ people like that. People always give complaints. They always complain. You know, in fact, there are people who you give them time. No time you give them, they must be late. If you say in the morning, they will be late. If you come in the afternoon, they are late. Come in the night, they are late. They are not even time, you know, time conscious in their thing. So work ethics, skill, you know, ability to work well with people, not just with people. Ability, you know, when you are not there, people know that, yeah, if you are there, something happens. They know that you are very effective, your contributions matters. Then we look at flexibility and adaptability skill. There are people, once they are in marketing, they cannot shift to other place. If you take them there, they will be sick. They are not flexible and they are not adaptable, you know, to that place. They also look at problem solving skill. Now, if you're going to be among the team, you must have these senses of solving problems. You talk about problem solving skill, you know. When problems are coming, people should think about you, not as the devil, as advocate. People should think about you and know that when you come, there's going to be problem. I mean, there's going to be solution to whatever problem that they are facing. Then number four, we look at interpersonal skill. Interpersonal, how well are you? And not only how well are you, how do you relate those skills you have to people, to yourself, and to people around you. Now let's look at accounting, education and provision for skill. Ability to communicate, coordinate, work under pressure, and solve problems is widely needed in all firms of organization. Then don't forget, I said ability to communicate. Now we'll be talking about this communication of a team I believe that we should be able to communicate, not only in figure, but also, you know, verbally or orally or written. We should be able. There are people who say, well, I'm very good orally, but you need to go to the other extent by being good in the written. Then coordinate, you know, to see two things, to bring things together and make them one. Then work under pressure and solve problems. Now, there are a lot of people who cannot work under pressure. Once there is a pressure on the ground, they are ready to shift base. I've seen people that will resign from their job because the pressure was much, and they think that pressure is going to kill them. I don't think it's going to kill anybody. So also, solve problem is widely needed in all firms of the organization, ability to solve problems. So you should not just be in an organization just to collect, but to find a way of solving problems. Now let's look at challenges in adult education. Challenges in adult education. There are so many challenges in adult education that if care is not taken, a lot of people, now talk there of people like us that went into school with in old age, you know, when we went to school in old age, there are so many things affecting us. The home front is there, the business is there, the church is there, the children are there. You know, you have to take care of all these things. They are all challenges. Now, if you don't make up your mind on what to do, you just discover that these challenges might pull you down. If I got to stage that I was telling myself, no, I have to drop because the challenge was much, you know, talk about finances, talk about the materials, talk about sometimes you get to school and there are materials you need to buy, and you too, you didn't even have money to take transport home. So those are various challenges. Now let's just look at about two or three of those challenges, then you can work on the other one. Number one, defining the domain of knowledge, skills. Defining the domain of knowledge, skill, and abilities in a field where there's no single definition of the domain. Defining the domain of skill, of knowledge, skill, and abilities in a field where there's no single definition of the domain. Like, you don't even know where to start from, whether to start from or to start from ABC. I remember a woman that came to me one day that she wanted to learn how to read and write. By the time we started, she just thought that for one day or 2 days, she'll just start and she starts reading. I said, no, it's not like that. It's going to take time. Number two, using performance assessment for multiple purpose and different audience. Using performance assessment for multiple purpose and different audience. Now, you need to understand we are two different. There are people, when you talk, they don't understand. But when you show it to them, they always understand. So you cannot really, you know, use one performance assessment for them. Then number three, having the fiscal resources required for assessment, development, training, implementation, and maintenance. When the federal and state monies under the Workforce Investment Act, West Africa of 1998, are limited for such activities. So you can see that there are a lot of things that are wrong. Now, number one, if you don't have enough money, Lord, to further your education, there's going to be problem. There's problem. I've had students that will say, sir, we couldn't get the handout just because they are financially, you know, stressed up. So those are part of it. Then number four, having sufficient time for assessment. So having sufficient time for assessment and learning opportunity, given the structure of adult education, programmers, and student-limited participation. There are people who will not participate because somehow they are not concentrating. Like I shared with you the other time, I have a home to look at. My children are in the school. I'm working in a place where I'm lowly paid and I have to pay school fees. So all these things, they bring limitation to the participants. Number five, developing expertise needed for assessment development. Now, there are not enough people that knows much about teaching of elders. You know, people who are already very old and they want to go. So they are not experts most in that area. Then social stereotypes. They have the social stereotypes where they belong. You know, some people, they don't believe they can just come down very low and they start learning some things. So they are social stereotype. Some people see themselves, maybe it's a small boy that's teaching them. They like all these things. They are not feeling comfortable in this area. Then we also look at poor motivation, fear of being misunderstood and showing competence. Now, There are a lot of people who are not motivated. You know, people don't talk to them. You know, they don't even have people to tell them, you can do it. You know, this should be somebody telling us, yes, you can do it. No, don't give up. You know, I remember my first day at the master class. And when I got home, I told my wife, I don't think I want to continue again. And you know, because we are studying in old age. And my wife said, if others can do it, you can do it also. So there should be somebody motivating you. Then number eight, problem with sight, memories and hearing. Wow, this is a great problem. There are people who are losing their sight already. You know, they can't see from far and they don't know it's problem. They don't know it's problem. Some cannot see from very close range. They can only see very far. Then issue of memory. How do we read? How do we put this in our memory? How do we read A, B, C and tomorrow come back and repeat the same thing? And also issue of hearing. There are people who are already deaf. You know, issue of deafness. Then number nine, we look at truanting. That is absenteeism, lack of time. People want to attend to their business, want to attend to their children, want to attend. Women want to attend to their husbands. They want to attend to so many things. So there's lack of time. So there are times they don't even go to school. They don't go. Number 10, shortage of teaching staff and poor training. Yeah, we don't have them. People don't do much about adult education. But thank God the school of education are helping now. Then the next one, number 11, is mindset. There's a lot of dirty mindset. People believe they can't know it. I've seen people that say, you know, a lady was telling me, say, sir, I don't know it. I don't want to know it. And I don't have money to pay. Then I told her, you are going to carry it over there. By next year, you'll take it. So there's a mindset. If you're an adult and you are doing this education, you must have a mindset that if others can make it, you can make it. If others can pass it, you can pass it. If I can do it in my old age, you can do it also. Talk less of these small ladies, kids that don't want to face obstacles. You don't want to face issues like this, that you must have a mindset. Then the last one there is financial barrier and flexibility. I've talked about this before, that there are a lot of financial barriers and lack of flexibility. People don't have money. Yes, they are willing. They are willing. Somebody told me, I remember when we got to school in those days, were so many that came that went, but by the time we got to the almost the second semester, a lot of people have withdrawn. And when we called them, they told us financial problems. So if you don't have people supporting you, you must be able to do something to support yourself. Now, let's look at types of adult education. We have different types of adult education. We have number one, education for vocationals, technical and professional competence. Now, it doesn't matter that you have to be formal and everything, though it's good to have at least the basis of education, formal education. But there are people, like I told you, there are people who are professionals, though they are not educated, you know, formally, but they are very. So they have vocational, you know, training like becoming a bricklayer, becoming a carpenter, and others. Those are vocationals. Then technical and professional competence. Now, the more I discover that the more you stay long in an establishment or in a profession, you have more techniques than everyone who are not there. Two, education for civic, political, and community competence. Civic, political, and community development. You know, we have this education also that deals with civic, political. Now, in the politics, you don't just come in and be a politician. You have to understudy. That's why in politics, you don't just come and carry the flag of the party. You have to go through a process. Three, education for health, welfare, and family living. We talk about that health, that people who are in their old age, they know how to attend to pregnant women and they give birth very safely. Then number six, education for self-fulfillment and self-direct learning. They just want to fulfill a course, not really they want to work. You know, if a 60 years old woman go to study for medicine, you know, it's not for working, because that's 7 years. By the time she finished, she's 67, she's already working, to just to fulfill self-fulfillment. Then we look at remedial education, that's online or distance learning or educational structural led courses, where you just go maybe once in a week, or it's a distance where you study like we are doing now. This is distance learning, and it's called the online instruction. Now, we look at basic accounting skills every professional accountant must have. Now, we told you beyond your formal education, beyond the degree, beyond the diploma, beyond the designation, there are so many things that you need to also, go through. Number one is the interpersonal skill. There's a missing conception that an accountant work only is just a figure. No, it's beyond figure. We've talked about the several attributes of the accountant. So you go back to that and read it. Two, taxation. Taxation is very volatile and dynamic subject. Now, before you prepare tax for anybody, you must know the rudiments of taxation. Three, analysis. That is analysis of accounting basis. You should be able, to analyze when a statement of account is released into your hands. You should be able to analyze and relate it to issues. So if somebody should ask you, like one of the things we talked about in the accounts, we said accounting should be relevant, should be able to analyze its relevance to what is happening. Then three, national certification. Now we have a lot of professional courses that you can go through. We have the ICAN, we have the ANAN, we have the ACCA, we have the ACA, we have so many of them like that that makes you to be certified as an accountant. So you need to do those courses to climb on. Then five, accounting software continues. Now, the software of accounting is not only in one place. There are diverse accounting software that you can go through and get. Nowadays, they even ask you, which software can you really manage? Then you have to tell them. They also look at written and oral communication. We'll be talking about this communication. A lot of us must begin to train ourselves in the area of this communication, be it oral, be it written communication, being gesture and all that. We need to write, we need to learn. Then the seventh one is critical thinking. Some people cannot think right. As a professional, you must be thinking. You must think, what can we remove to increase the productivity of the organization or the profit margin of the organization? What can we add that is not going to cost us money that make things happen? I remember a secretary one day, just thought about how much they are spending on the internet. And she had to go to the internet house to go and bargain for it. And she was giving almost 25%, for her knowing how to bag it. How did she do that? She thought about it. So thinking is one of it. Then number eight, persuasivism. That's human resources professional will commonly say that building consensus is a key character for a leader. You must be able to persuade people to work, even when they are delegated. Then number nine, technology and computer skill. Now, I've talked about that before, that the technologies are changing. Formerly, we said every 6 months. Now it's every 3 months. New technologies are being released. Then we talked about the leadership. And I said to us, there's no way you can work without having a leadership skill. You cannot work. So you must learn to work and have some leadership skills. Now let's go to accounting softwares. What is accounting software? Accounting software is a fundamental application that allows an organization to record the flow of money for internal and external revenue and auditing. Let me come again. I said, accounting software is a fundamental application that allows an organization to record the flow of money for internal and external revenue and auditing. It is the primary tool for assessing the financial health of an organization and for meeting the legal compliance through tools like general ledger, accounting payable and receivable, purchases order, stock management journals, payroll, fair balance, and billings. I will explain that later and more clearly. when I get to a certain stage like that. Then we also look at it, describe the type of application that records and process accounting transaction within functional modules. It describes a type of application that record and process accounting transactions within functional modules. Now let's look at the features of accounting software. The features of accounting software. Number one, quick accounting. Accounting was a fairly manual process that involves using pen and paper to improve. Accounting software was introduced so that it can be faster. Now, you know, in those days, we use broadsheets. You know, when you go to collect money, they check your name, what you have received, and others. Then at the end of the day, they tell you your balance. And at the end, you know, so there are so many staff doing that. But these days, because of software, it is so quick, you don't need all those pen and paper. Or you just type the name of the person in the account, and the account will be released into you. Two, secured. It must have a good security, as the transaction details of the company are stored on the software. Now, the accounts of the organization must be secure. That is why it's just few people that always have the key to the financial, you know, security of the organization. Just few people, they don't have the password, except people hack into the password. Now, it is easy to use. Number three, it is very easy to use. When you use the accounting software, it is very, very easy to use. And three, costs. Though at the beginning it's costly, but once set, it's costless. At the beginning it's very costly, but once it is set, it becomes costless. It's just something, all you need to do is just, once your system is on online, just do the upgrade of your system. Upgrade your system, and doesn't take you anything to upgrade your systems, except the accountants you bring in. The new accountant does not want what you are using, the software you are using, and you want to change the software. That's the only time that you have problem with it. But before I continue the importance of accounting software, let's take this assignment. Before I continue the importance of accounting software, let's take this assignment so that we can read. And the assignment is, number one, what is a nominal account? Number one, what is a nominal account? Number two, distinguish between personal and impersonal account. Number two, distinguish between personal and impersonal account. Number three, what are the classification of ledger accounts? What are the classification of ledger accounts? Classification of ledger accounts. What are the classification of ledger accounts? Number one question, what is a nominal account? Two, distinguish between personal and impersonal accounts. Three, what are the classification of ledger accounts? Now send your answer to my mail, geoba2804@gmail.com. geoba2804@gmail.com. Geoba is GEOGBA. GEOGBA 2804@gmail.com. That is it. That's where you send it to. And you must make sure that you send it through. You send it before the next lecture. Before the next lecture. Now, because of our few time, let's just look at importance of accounting software. What are the importance of accounting software? Number one, it gives an insight of overall financial performance of the business. Once you press your button, you type in to know what is going on. It brings every insight, what you are spending, what goes out in the day, what goes out in all the other day. It gives every, you know, financial performance of the business. Now, also, you'll be able to know if you are making profit or you are not making profit, or if there's some areas that you need to close up in that business so that you can retain profit. You better do that. Number two, it handles all financial aspects of the business. So stroke the companies, all the financial, the receipt payable, the receipts, receivable, and others, your ledger, you know it, and others. It gives us the how to handle it. Then you'll be able to share the job. Number three, it manages the general ledger, comma, accounts receivable, and accounts payable. It manages the general ledger, account receivable, and account payable. Then number four, it allows tracking of cash flow, comma, revenue and expenses. You can track what cash is coming in some accounts. Once you enter your inventories, every other inventories begin to pick up. Those areas that money needs to go, you'll be able to know. You know how much cash you are making in a day. You know how much cash is spent. Also, you look at your revenue and cross it to expenses. And this can also help you to do better in the setting up of your accounting, you know, organization or department. Then we look at number five, it's aid check and balance. It's aid check and balance. You'll be able, you can tell the financial manager that they are spending too much, they need to reduce it, then you'll be able to know what is going on. Then this type, let's look at types of accounting software. Types of accounting software. I will leave you to go and work on that, very much to work on that. That we look at database accounting software, where we use data, you know, we have different type of database accounting software. Then two, we have installed accounting software. That one is that it's in the computer. Once you enter your this thing like Fountain and others, you will just enter and it's bigger. In fact, it helps you your payroll. It helps you your payroll. Just put the name of the person and your payroll is out for you. Then we also look number three, cloud accounting software. I want to leave you to go and check that. And I want to have the result of that. Possibly you add that to the accounting assignment. Now, let's look at the feature of accounting software. What are the features? Number one, accounts receivable, that is order to cash, you know, the cash that comes in, then also what is paid out. Two, accounts payable, that's procedure to payment, you know, what you pay out, you know, who is receiving it, you'll be able to know that. Then we look at financial close, the financial closely, close account, look at it financially. You can easily detect if you are making profit in a day or you are not making profit in a day. You can detect that. Four, time and expenses capture. And you'll be able to know there are some organizations that's using time factor to pay people. So you clock your card, your card goes to the system. When you clock out, immediately your salary is worked out. So look at time. And the expenses are captured. Who is spending what department? Which department is spending too much? How do we reduce the flow of that money in that department? Then we also look at the five elements of accounting. The five elements of accounting. One, asset. Assets are the resources which the business used to conduct the financial, the organizational activities. Your assets, your land, your properties, your cash at hand, all those are your assets. Two, we look at liabilities. Now, I told you, it's not every liability that is owing, the liability that brings money, like you borrow money in the bank and the money is used to run the business. At the end of the day, it becomes your asset, not just. The only thing that is called liability, anything that is taking money from you and it's not returning back the money, that's a liability. So these are groups of items which are obligatory to the business. Then we look at expenses. Look at expenses. You know, the expenses must be monitored or you spend more than that. And that's why people, you know, before the company starts, a lot of calculation would have been done on what to spend, what not to spend, what comes in and what does not come in. Then we also look at revenue. Your revenue, your expenses must not be more than your revenue. If it's more than that, that's automatic loss. That is automatic loss. So you must check your revenue. You must check your expenses. Then we look at the owner's equity. The owner's equity, that means the owner, business owner is different to his business. The owner is different to his business. So don't let anybody tell you that It's my money, it's our business. Most especially if you have gone public, that money belongs to the public and it is no more your money. It is a public money. So you must know how to handle your business and also handle your money properly. If not, you run the business onto a loss. You run the business to a loss. And once the business is at loss, then you close up the business. The next thing is closing up the business. Now, let's look at the classification of accounting. Classification of accounting. I don't know if time is going to permit us to do this, but let me just list them. If time permits, then I will expatiate on it. Or in the next class, we'll come back again. Number one is real account. Real account. Under real account, we have the real account, tangible and intangible. Now, when we talk about tangible, we talk about land, building, machinery, motor vehicle, fixtures and fittings. Those are tangible accounts. Now, we equate them to your assets. They are your assets. Though intangible also are not assets also, but, you know, in a different way. When we talk about intangible, those are the things we cannot touch, we cannot hold, we cannot stand. Those are intangible, like wages, like goodwill, like patents, trademarks, and so many other. Then lastly, for us to end the program today, we look at nominal account. These accounts that receive value in money only. It's related to gain or losses to organization. And such nominal accounts, we talk about wages, talk about rent, talk about health, we talk about, you know, salaries, we talk about income and loss or profit. Then we also look at personal account. These are accounts of person that have business relations. It may refer to personal owing the business and equally to person to which the business owes. And lastly, before I stop today, we'll look at the impersonal account. These accounts that do not refer to persons. So next week, we shall talk about the remaining. Thank you so much. God bless you.